2016 PCS, the annual meeting. Hi. I'm Todd Hackett, CEO of PCS Adventures. This is Robert Grover, Executive Vice President of PCS, and Mike Bledsoe, Vice President of Treasurer of PCS. And they're both on the board of directors. We'll get the meeting started. First of all, we'll go through the election of the board of directors. It was passed. Your current board of directors was voted on and passed. Our accounting firm, M&K, is our CPA firm. That was voted on and passed. The authorization of going from 100 million to 150 million shares was voted on and passed. And I also want to say that we don't have intentions of using those 150 million shares in the immediate future. It's there for purposes of if we down the road have to use that for capital or acquisitions, whatever that might be. But at the current time, we are not planning to issue a ton of shares. Also, the executive plan for employees, there was a vote to increase it from 8 million to 10 million shares, and that was approved, and there was no other business that was brought in to bring up in front of the board. So I want to thank you guys all for coming, and the current shareholders for sticking with PCS, and we appreciate all you guys. And I want to introduce Mike Bledsoe. He's relatively new to the company. He's been here 2.5 months.
2.5 months since July 1.
And as Mike just wants to have a little bit to say.
Yeah, I don't want to take away. We have a dynamite presentation for you today. I think some fresh information that's going to give you a wonderful update on the company. I want you to know that you as shareholders have got an incredibly talented team of employees here at PCS. Every day they work hard, very passionate about what they do. You know, unfortunately their hard work isn't showing up in the numbers yet, but it will. And I feel like we're very close to turning the corner and having that happen. You know, like everybody else here that does every day, I'm gonna pin my ears back, I'm gonna give you everything I've got. I'm very proud of the team here, I'm very honored to be part of it. And I wanna thank all the shareholders here for your support and your patience, and I would tell you to sit back and watch what we're going to do for you over the next 12 months. So thank you for coming today, Mr. Chairman.
Okay, going on, I just want to give you some highlights of accomplishments and so forth over the year and kind of let you know what we're working on and so forth. Last year we had the revenue increase from 15 to 16 was approximately $400,000, from 2.9 million to 3.3 million. Not what we were hoping for, not what we were expecting. We think that we've got it much better place right now than going forward. We've completed last year approximately $1 million contract for Saudi Arabia. That was fulfilled and completed in last fiscal year. The catapult order, that was the largest catapult. Every year for the last 3 or 4 years, it's grown pretty much every year. Started out as Edison, then turned into catapult, and we did approximately $500,000 with catapult last year, and 3 years ago, I think it was $300,000.
Yeah.
So, I mean, every year it's grown the business with them. Same way with Stemfinity. Every year, on the Stemfinity products and that, they've grown the same way basically, and they were in the same situation. Started out a lot less 3 years ago, and now it's up to approximately the same, about 500,000. And we think we're gonna move that higher with both these companies. Are very pleased with our products, and Heidi's done a great job, and Michelle, getting the products in a better shape than ever, probably, as far as the product line for the company. And I think that that's really going to pay off for us with our suppliers and not suppliers, our distributors of our products. So looking at it from that standpoint, we've made a lot of progress over the last year, 2 years, although it hasn't shown yet in the revenues like we had hoped. We think you're going to see it coming up. Let's see. We also did last year the acquisition of Thrust, which was in February 15th, I believe. And that was what you see here. It was a start of it, what you see here. And Joe's going to go into more detail in a little bit when he speaks. And EJ was the founder of Thrust. We acquired Thrust from EJ. And we now took it to the stage. This is what we've been working on for 6 months. We've been working on this product. We worked out all the bugs. We could have taken it to market sooner, but we didn't have 100%. And we wanted to be 100% so we could have the best product on the market to capture the racing drone market. And we believe we do have that now. And we took it to our first distributor yesterday, and we got an overwhelming response. We have 12 or 15 distributors. I'm not gonna say names, but the one we went to yesterday was one of the largest in the United States. And we're meeting with two or three others of the largest in the United States in the next week. So we think we got a winner. We think it's going to be great for the market. It came in number 4th in the Long Island
Drone National
race on Long Island. So I mean, we believe it's the right product for the right market. While we talk about the drones, we also have an education drone. Did we bring that? This is called the Ruby Cube, which there's a few minor changes on the final. This will go in an education pack. This the upper side of this is red. The camera will be mounted in here, from what I understand, right?
Yeah.
Okay. And basically, this will come as components that in a kit that the kids will be able to, mostly high school, I don't know, junior high too or not, high school, will be able to put together in their STEM learning class and learn about drones and so forth. We have been very successful so far with this. It's in the final stages. We're basically done with the R&D on it. We hope to get this into the marketplace at the end of October. This will be the middle of October. This will be sold with curriculum, the school one, and it's not even on the market yet, and we've already have orders for the kits. And the kits are not just the drone. You get 5 drones, goggles, and controllers, and each kit sells for $6,000, $5,900 some dollars. So when I say that we're getting response, it's not like you get one order, it's $300, it's thousands of dollars. So am I missing anything on this? Any key points or not on the right? Anyway, we're having a very good response from kids within the school there. There's 25,000 high schools in the United States. So do the math. I mean, if you can sell to 10% of them, you sold a lot of dollars.
It's pretty exciting.
So anyway, that's just some of the projects that we've been working on. And we've spent a tremendous amount of money on R&D over the last 6 months. And we're about to see the reward of that. So. Anyway, just wanted to give you a highlight on that. Also, some of the successes that we are working on are Saudi Arabia. Let's see, the 825
development. That's the tracker.
Oh yeah, okay. Yeah, the tracker contract that we announced on an 8K, that was started out as when EJ started working with them a long time ago, as probably 6 months or more. We actually got a contract with them. We announced in February. We acquired the Thrust from EJ on
on approximately February 15th, and I believe by March, we had a contract for $825,000 of doing the development of a tracker device for drones. Drones, et cetera, out of Salt Lake City. And we hope to do more business with them. Again, a tremendous amount of money has been spent on the R&D. We worked on that since then. The prototype is in their hands now. So it's to the point that we're basically real close to going into production. So we've spent all the money is what I'm trying to say. Now it's time that we get the rewards from all the R&D. So we also, Robert and his connections with Saudi Arabia landed a $693,000 contract that we announced here approximately 2 months ago.
Yeah, July.
So our Saudi business continues to grow, I should say. We completed the $1 million one last year. We have another contract that we're working on right now that would be
$1 million on that one,
an approximate range of the $700,000 range that would be in addition to this one. And we're in negotiations on some much larger seven-figure contracts. Forward-looking, I want to make sure everybody understands that, because there's no guarantees when you're dealing with anything until you have it signed and done. So both those are forward-looking. But we believe we have a good shot at it. Our products are we spent a lot of time and money over the last many years. Robert's done a tremendous amount of work and a good job building our products into the Saudi structure so we can try and be the one to supply them curriculum and train out their teachers. And we are in there. I know it's taken a lot longer than any of us expected. I just hope that everything goes well and eventually here, hopefully in the not too distant future, that we will see some of the rewards from that from many years of work. And that's kind of where that is. The wireless, the video contract, we had a contract to create I'm talking thrust on this one now, back to thrust. The last two were PCS, the education side. Now we go to thrust. We had a pilot contract to create a camera system. Do we talk names or not?
Probably not. Yeah, that's confidential right now. Yeah.
Anyway, at this point we had a contract. We completed that contract. The owner is in the process, or the that we developed the contract for was for video cameras, basically, through, it's for video cameras, and we'll leave it at that.
Yeah, one of the things that, the projects that he's talking about, a lot of these are spin-off technology. So the core technology that these guys are building in our drones have applications all over the place. So within literally weeks of acquiring Thrust, we have these other contract opportunities coming up, and I think we see a lot more of those coming down the road.
We think so too. And that was a smaller contract. It was a $48,000 contract, but it was completed, and the owners evaluating it and appear to like it, and they will hopefully be issuing more contracts to us. Existing Riot. Again, we're now entering into the sales stages. Our initial sales stages, we're going to focus mainly on distributors, and that will be our primary focus at this time. We're not going to actively retail it ourselves at this particular time. We're going to focus through distributors. Many of these hobby shops have in a couple cases thousands of hobby shops that they distribute to, the different wholesalers, I'm going to say, and we're in that area that we're focusing on right now for the Riot. Eventually we will be looking again forward looking we're looking at doing some kind of a retail complete package. It would have goggles, controller, and drone. Won't maybe look exactly like this. We don't know yet. That's down the road quite a ways. But just so you know what we are thinking in our heads. Basically, that kind of gives you an overview of where we've been doing for the last year, as well as aggressively for the many, many months, 6 months or more. We had hoped to be the market a little sooner, and it just took longer. Again, we wanted to have it 100%. We could have rushed it through, but we had one shot to do it and do it right. So we took it, and we'd rather trade off the time for having not a quality product at the market. And the one thing that sets us apart from other drones, number one, we're one of the few that are white. Number two, ours is going to be assembled in the U.S., where a lot of them are in China. There is some value to that. We feel we have better control of the product right now, versus if we would have had it made in China, we'd have to have somebody over there. We'd have been trying to monitor it. This way, if there's any glitches, we can fix them in-house, and get the best product possible out to the market. So I want to, that's all I have to say, other than I do want to thank all the employees for all their hard work, and they've done a lot of work, and every single one of them. And I want to turn it over to Robert for some follow-up.
Next up. Yep. Well, welcome everybody. So the way we've set up the meeting, Todd's given you a pretty good overview of everything that's happened in the past year, and then from the beginning of the new fiscal year to today. And then Joe and I are going to take a little time and go into both of the core business groups and explain to you in a little bit more detail what Todd was introducing to you. So I'm going to go through some of the STEM initiatives and just give you some ideas of what's going on the STEM side. There's been a lot of tremendous improvements in the company, efficiency, products, sales systems, everything over the past year. And that, both Todd and Mike said, that's because of the people we've got here. There's a lot of dedication, there's a lot of crazy hours that people are working. But, bottom line is they believe in it. If you go out to Thrust and you watch people working on these things till 4 a.m, if you see Nikki or Heidi or Michelle and the hours that they're putting in to make sure that the STEM products are perfect, you don't get that kind of commitment to something that people just don't believe in. So you have a lot of passion, and the people here are what is going to make this happen. So on the STEM side, I broke it up into some different things that I wanted to give you a little bit more detail on. I've got several slides I'll go through, but one is to talk a little bit about the sales infrastructure, our resellers, the growth of our sales team, our management processes. Talk to you a little bit about product updates. We have some fabulous product updates that have happened in the last year and a half. Again, because of the serious amount of work and dedication to quality that people are putting into the product lines. A little bit about Edventures Lab, which, this is one of our premier products that you're actually sitting in. And Edventures Lab is a place where we test the things that are going into the schools. It's where we develop the technology that we sell into places like Saudi Arabia. It's the place where we actually test with kids drones. So this summer, Nikki had the great pleasure of working with a bunch of kids building drones. Michelle was testing curriculum, kind of crash drones regularly. So, the whole company is working very well together in terms of using the resources that we have. And all of these things, which may seem somewhat disconnected from the outside, are really tightly intertwined. STEM education, drones, I'll tell you a little bit about how that all ties together. But all of it is a very rich platform for creating some of the best education experiences in the world, as well as I think some of the best entertainment experiences in the world. So that's what I'm going to go through. We'll start with talking a little bit about sales and some of the progress we've made. Last year, it's been just a little over a year ago, we announced a partnership with a company called School Specialty. And School Specialty is one of the largest resellers into the school market in the United States. They do over $500 million a year. They have about a dozen different brands and properties that they push into the schools at different levels, everywhere from preschool clear through to high school and tech ed. And our initial announcement was that we were going to partner with them on Frey Scientific, which is one of their brands. Frey is a company that focuses on high school science, middle school science, and they sell products like probeware, where kids are, you know, learning how to acquire data and analyze it. They sell scientific apparatus. They have existing contracts with 90% of the districts within the country, which is very big. When you're working with large districts like Miami-Dade, those are almost a small government that you're working with. You know, they're on such a scale. So to actually have existing vendor contracts and relationships is huge. So the first products that we released with Frey last year was our Discover Robotics series. And they featured our robotics. These are actually catalog pages right out of Frey. This is what's going to be published this year. Last year we had a full page spread and we were the featured product in their robotics section. So Frey has invested a lot of time and energy into learning about our products. We've gone through a lot of training. We've had Dalton, for example, has been out on site with a number of those people. She's conducted webinars trying to get those people up to speed on the product. One of the things that is very challenging in the school market is the amount of time it takes to get people trained on things and then to actually get products introduced into the system and finally acquired, budgeted, and purchased. So it is a long game. You know, it's a vision that you have to have some commitment to. You continue to support those people, you get them trained, and eventually you're going to start seeing purchase orders coming in from bigger districts. And the hockey stick concept is very true in the education space. It'll take several years to actually get your products accepted, to have trial pilot programs going, and then finally they get, you know, bigger acceptance and they start to take off. That's where we're at with Frey and with School Specialty. They were so excited about our products this year that they expanded beyond robotics. They actually added in, I think, most of our products. Heidi, who does all of our product management and marketing, went through all of our products and came up with, I think, the sweet spot, the sweet offering of everything from, you know, our robotics packages to summer camps to Brick Lab. The Brick Lab product, we're very excited about. We did some major improvements on it this year. Brick Lab is, I think, maybe one of the easiest things to sell. When we started introducing products to Frey, robotics is not easy to sell. Okay, there's a lot of competition out there, it's complicated, and you have to be very comfortable with it. So we're working with those guys to get them comfortable. And just to differentiate, Frey as one division has about 13 salespeople that work in the United States on the high school level. School Specialty overall has 300 salespeople in all of these multiple divisions. So what they did is they opened all of our products up this year to all 300 people. And this new catalog that it's actually going to print now, it drops in January, will be going out not to just to Frey, but there's also products that are being pushed out to all of these other properties. So people selling into the elementary schools, preschool programs, and bricks, frankly, we feel are a lot easier to sell. You don't even have to plug them in, they just work. So we think that that's gonna be a big, big seller for us this year. Anyway, the bottom line is that it takes time to build a sales and distribution network, but we feel like this reseller partner is going to be huge for us. We just need to stick with it and keep moving the ball down the field. As I said, they're very big. They've got lots of existing contracts with districts out there, and I think it'll start to pay off. We just need to keep nurturing them. Some of our other resellers, Stemfinity, as Todd had mentioned, continues to grow. They did over $500,000 this year. We see pretty steady growth with them. With the new products and things that we're introducing, you know, we anticipate continued growth, and we're trying to put together some really good support systems to get them more excited and better trained about the programs. Dalton also added on some other resellers this year for us, which one of them is called Educate Me. What was the Canadian company?
We're in negotiations, but we're basically signing the contract.
Okay, so you have a new Canadian reseller coming on. And then there's a third one that you've been working with. So, you know, the number of people actually bringing our products to market is continuing to increase. And the more people see our brand and see our products, obviously, the more credibility and the more sales you'll see. Last thing I wanted to mention just on the sales front is in terms of sales infrastructure. We've talked about resellers, but internally we've also increased our efficiency and our systems. I'd like to introduce Alexandra Monjard. She is our new sales director. She's been with us for over a year now as our sales coordinator. And in that time, she demonstrated all of the skills that you need to actually manage a sales team efficiently. Sales management these days is a numbers game, and it's analytics, it's monitoring, it's tracking. She has all of those skills. She's become a master of our database, which is saying a lot. And she's developed very good relationships with our salespeople and is implementing new systems to help track them, give them more incentives, and make them more effective. And she's also adding more salespeople on. So we're excited about our internal sales staff, which focuses on the after-school market. And we're also very excited about resellers that are going after the classroom market, which is much bigger. So between those two initiatives, we will cover everybody. So product highlights, I'll go through these fairly quickly. Brick Lab I mentioned. We do have some bricks here. So after the meeting, you might want to take a minute and look at the new packaging and how we've configured them. The Brick Lab is something we've been selling for over a decade. We've gone through a number of different suppliers. We have our own manufacturer now. We actually manufacture our own brick in South Korea. And we call it the perfect brick. We've been in pursuit of the perfect brick now for a long time. You're all familiar with Lego bricks. This is very similar to Lego. It's completely compatible with Lego, but it's actually better in a lot of ways. You know, the corners are rounded. We've actually used, I think, every major brand in the market for this Brick Lab curriculum. And some of the bricks were so sharp they would cut teachers' fingers. Some of them kids can't get apart. Some of them just fall apart. So there's a pretty interesting recipe that you have to hit. And after many, many years, I think we've hit the perfect brick. And our development and marketing people put together beautiful packaging this year. And we think we're going to sell a lot of bricks. We just brought in a container load about 6 weeks ago. And we're starting to push those out into the market now. So we're very excited about Brick Lab. Brick Lab's very versatile because you can apply so many different curriculum topics to it. So it's useful from preschool, you know, clear through the elementary grade range. And if you think about the number of schools out there, there's over 50,000 elementary public schools. We want to get a Brick Lab into every classroom ultimately. So if you were able to do that, this isn't forward looking, this is just market potential. So if you were able to drop one of these Brick Labs on a curriculum into every classroom in America, that's over $1 billion in potential sales. So we've got a really good sized market, got great products, and we've got a great sales team that's come together to help push them out into that marketplace. So very simple product. We can make those in any quantity we need, as fast as we need, and deliver them. So we're looking forward to ramping that up. Dronology was launched last year, and Dronology is part of the overall business plan, which is taking our products into a digital format. Also in this lab, after we finish the meeting, you may want to look at what are called lab cards, which is our new curriculum format, which is a hard copy. The plan is to take all of that curriculum into the digital system so that you can actually license and sell that digitally, you know, and create subscription and license revenue. All of the underlying structure of the business plan is to build out recurring revenue. So every year you have licenses that are renewing. Ultimately, we want to have, you know, millions of students accessing our online system and delivering all of the curriculum, whether it's on drone technology, whether it's on engineering, robotics, programming, and have that on tap. We're configuring all of that for use on mobile devices. So as you all know, students have tablets, mobile devices at their hands all the time. We want to be connected to those students and delivering experiential education through those devices. So Dronology was actually launched, our digital platform is up, and the plan now is to start working on expanding that and bringing in the next round of titles so that we can start licensing it. Other things, Science of Superpowers, this is just an example of one of our enrichment camps. Camps are a very big business for us. Todd had mentioned Catapult Learning, which is one of our clients that we did over $500,000 with just on summer camp materials. I think since January, Heidi was telling me we've done well over $800,000. Just in summer camp packages, and that'll continue to grow. That's a niche that we fill very well, because a lot of the camp experiences really are experiential in nature. Kids are doing hands-on activities, whether it's, you know, learning about the science of superpowers, or whether they're doing the physics of the ninja, or they're doing something in architecture. They're always building, producing, designing, creating something. So summer camps is something that we're very good at, and those camp experiences, I think we must have, how many curriculum titles do we have in summer camps now?
Good ones?
20.
Oh.
Over 20. So yeah. So it's great business for us, and we're very we're very unique in that. There are very few other providers out there, so we feel like we've got a niche market that we continue to capture. A lot of curriculum development, lab cards, a lot of different titles have been released. 3D printing, which Tom was asking about earlier. We have a 3D printer here. But 3D printers are popping up in classrooms and makerspaces, libraries all over the country. So we've created curriculum to support those. And this actually is online with school specialty as well. I was going through the school specialty catalog last night online. All of our titles are popping up, all of our different kits and products. So excited about those because a lot of companies like school specialty are selling 3D printers. They need curriculum to partner with. In fact, I think Dalton's actually got somebody that's a 3D printer distributor that's looking for additional curriculum to bundle with their products. So things like that, we look for the things that are hottest in the market, what are being adopted in educational trends, and we build curriculum and activities around those. The very last product I want to point out was RubyQ, which Todd introduced you a little bit. This is what RubyQ will actually look like in the final stage. It's going to be red. It's going to have an integrated circuit board. So this one, which is kind of a original initial prototype, is pretty complicated for kids to build, which Nikki can attest to. The newer ones are going to be a lot easier to build. They're very modular, so the kids can build them quickly, learn the systems and subsystems, and then we take them back apart and use them again. But a great training ground for kids. We feel like the marketplace for drones in the schools is going to be enormous, just because of the sex appeal of the technology. You know, when, in fact, I talked a little bit about this in the context of Saudi Arabia, which is what I was going to explain next. The reason we got into the drone technology is because of the contract that Todd mentioned last year, in which we were developing a learning framework, curriculum, and lab environments for Saudi Arabia. And one of the areas that we were working on was advanced robotics. And obviously, there's nothing more advanced in terms of robotics or more engaging for kids than a drone. They're literally a flying STEM platform. So you've got all kinds of applications that you can teach with them, ranging from programming electronics to aerodynamics, material science, a lot of amazing things. And that's actually how we got involved in the drone space. When we were developing this curriculum, I had the great honor of meeting EJ, who was running Thrust UAV and building drones and selling those to the local FPV crew. And this was early last 2016, early in 2016, late 2015, yeah, over a year ago. Anyway, this is how we got involved in the drone space. The more I got to know EJ and the more we became familiar with the technology, the more excited we got about it, because you can see how it directly connects to STEM education. EJ ended up being our partner in creating our actual drones that we supplied to Saudi Arabia. We shipped a number of educational drones to Saudi as we closed out this contract last year. And that's really how the whole thing started. You know, the more we worked with EJ and the more familiar we became with the opportunity, both on the racing side and the connections to the SIM side, the more natural it became that we should come together, which I'm glad to see we have, because the output is going to be remarkable, I think, for all of us. Anyway, the educational drone, that's how it was born. In fact, I believe this is really a descendant of the one that you built for Saudi Arabia. So, it's a lot better. So kids in Saudi Arabia are actually using an original version of this, and now we've improved it, and we'll start going into classrooms here in the United States. But at the end of my discussion, I'm going to play you a short video which shows you some of the applications of drones in education. But really, the opportunity is huge if you think about the number of high schools that are out there. One of the things that Dalton's been working on is a high school racing network so that you can get kids at the high school level actually creating leagues and competing against one another. We've had a lot of discussions with the State Department of Education. They're on board with it. We've already got pilot sites in Idaho that want to participate. So if you can imagine 25,000 high schools out there all buying our drone kits, training on them, and building towards an actual racing league, which we would be the primary supplier of those parts, you know, the opportunity on the education side is huge, and it's a win-win for everybody. It's exciting education. It's exciting for the kids. It's great business for us. It's a lot of fun. So I think the whole connection between drones and STEM education, to me, is very evident. I hope you all see it, and you'll get to see more of it as we get into the classrooms, and hopefully you'll get to experience some of this if you go out and visit Joe at Thrust after this meeting. Get to see it hands-on. So let's see, quick summary of Saudi Arabia. I think I'm about ready to wrap up and turn this over to Joe. I already explained a little bit about the contract that we executed. You know, since we started conducting business with them, it took a number of years to actually get in and become trusted and start to do business. We've done, I think, $1.7 million in contracts, not including the one that we're doing right now, which is another $693,000. So that puts us, you know, about $2.5 million. We're working on additional follow-up contracts. The strategic plan for Saudi Arabia is kind of a long 100-year business plan, if you will. The first thing we did is we partnered with them to create their curriculum framework, which is based on what's in this lab. So the R&D that we do in this lab, when we're creating things like our learning framework and our merit system, all of those things, the pedagogy, how the curriculum's designed, were applied to creating a curriculum framework and a lab design for Saudi Arabia. So if you look at, again, at this as one big product, what we've done is monetized it by licensing it and replicating it to Saudi Arabia. So the next step, you know, last year for that $1 million, we produced a framework, which is how they organize their curriculum, and we produced over 20 volumes of curriculum in a number of different topics that range from things like electronics, flight studies, programming, mechanical engineering. So we've given them a very rich STEM framework, which interestingly requires materials for each lab that they build out. And I think you can all guess who supplies those materials, which is us. So the order that Todd was referring to earlier, which, you know, it should be another, we think it'll probably be in the $600,000 to $700,000 range if it comes through. Again, that is forward looking, none of those things are guaranteed. But as we continue to build out with Saudi Arabia, you know, we're through this first strategic initiative where we're now placed as their STEM provider. And as they expand into schools, they come back to us to purchase materials. You know, we shipped the first round of materials to them towards the end of last year. And the warehouse is well designed now and efficient for kitting those up and shipping them out. Now it's just a matter of scaling. Saudi Arabia has over 30,000 schools. And, you know, ultimately I'd love to see a brick lab in every one of those as well. So it's a big market. It's not an easy market. Certainly not. A lot of people would not have had the tenacity to stick with it the way this company has. And that's a testament to Todd and his commitment to seeing it through, as well as his predecessor. You know, it's taken years for us to gain the credibility and trust of the Saudi Arabian government and the Ministry of Education. Now I think we're going to start seeing the return on that. It's not the fast return you'd like to see, but I think long term it's going to be, you know, significant, and I think it'll be really good for the company. So that's where we're at with Saudi Arabia. This is actually a rendering of one of the lab designs we did. This is their space and aeronautics lab. This is actually where some of those drones will end up. What we're doing right now with the current contract is implementing these designs into a lab in Qassim, which is near Riyadh. So as we wrap that up, we'll start looking towards pushing supplies into schools and into these centers. So that's kind of how the progression continues. Already talked a little bit about drones. Yeah, Paul.
Is the question appropriate at this time?
Sure, go ahead.
So PCS, as you know, I know, has been almost exclusively in schools, education. But these days, especially with the topic of drones as such importance, are the various negotiations underway in more commercial and more military sense?
Absolutely, yeah. And Joe's going to actually talk about some of that. So we're going to have a question and answer section at the end. And I think Joe actually is going to probably introduce some of those very concepts that you're interested in. Because, yeah, the drone space, obviously, there's lots of opportunity there. Yeah. So anyway, this is more on the drones, which I think I've already explained, the number of schools that are out there. This is our education package that Todd was describing. So it comes with a number of drones, controllers. It utilizes the Droneology curriculum that was produced last year. It's a great program. It's been tested pretty thoroughly. We're looking forward to getting the actual educational drones into production, which also will be next month, and start to fulfill these. Because as Todd had mentioned, we've already got people ordering them. So we're excited about that opportunity. And I think one of the things that's going to help with our market visibility and our branding is to be the leader in drone education, because there's nobody out there that has a polished curriculum and offering like this at this time. So one of the challenges we run into when we sell our robotics programs at the lower grade levels is that we're competing with Lego and nobody's heard of us. If we come in as the premier, you know, advanced robotics provider for things like STEM drone programs, that's going to help us push our programs down to the lower levels as well. So that's a big opportunity for building our brand as well as our credibility in the marketplace. And this is where I was going to wrap up. This is a demonstration video that we put together for FIRST Robotics earlier this year. FIRST Robotics is a nationwide robotics competition, and it's really a framework and a model that we're looking at for the drone competition that we want to implement. So this will give you an idea of how kids apply drones and you know, how we see it connecting to STEM. So this was actually aired at Taco Bell Arena over at Boise State University to many, many people. I don't know how many thousands of people attended the FIRST Robotics event, but it was packed, and they were from all over the West.
Glad to see you all here today. Thank you for coming. I want to cover a few of our products that our very robust R&D team has been working on over the last 6 months. You guys have an extremely talented group of people that work at this company, not only on the education side, but also on the drone side. And they put in tremendous hours and tremendous effort. So one of the first things that I want to talk about is the Riot 250R Pro, which everybody's very interested in. Turn on
here. Just so you know, I'm sorry, I should have introduced him. Joe's the business manager out of Thrust, so.
This is safe to pass around, isn't it?
Yeah, that's safe to pass around.
Yeah, okay.
That's the non-fly model.
I'll take a look at it.
Can I turn that on?
We have one that we pack around that can't take off, so. We don't want anybody getting their fingers cut off. That is a 250-millimeter drone. It's made out of carbon fiber. It's gel-coated carbon fiber, which you do not see in the market. It's something that we hold, nobody else has. We've The R&D team has went through, produced, and developed a power distribution board, which is the top board that the battery sets on. So all of those electronics are embedded in that board. There's really no wiring other than the ESCs that you see off the arms. You can see the difference in our beta here, which is full of wiring. And for any race vehicle, be it a car, a drone, weight is a big factor. And so that's what the team has done, is they've stripped that weight. That particular drone, we've clocked at 89 miles an hour. It's extremely fast. They're flown FPV, so you wear goggles. It looks like you're flying a Mustang P51. That's what it looks like. And in fact, I'd like to invite all you guys to come out to the shop. We'll do some flights. You guys can put the goggles on. We'll set you down so you don't fall over. But it's very, very exciting. It is the new Xbox. This is Xbox on steroids, is what it is. Kids, adults, everyone, when you guys see this, you're just going to go, it's going to blow your mind. On top of that, we're also approaching the market as to people that are going to build their own drones. This drone's going to come built, almost ready to fly. So the R&D department has been working on parts that we can sell to our to the consumer base that's going to build their own drones. We can even sell to the people that are flying other drones. And that's how we're approaching the market. So they've been working on a flight control board called the Podium. We're coming out with a race-driven line of products that will go into the market and can be used on anyone's drones, not only ours. That would be in the spare parts. On the contract side, on the R&D side, they've been working really, really hard on a GPS tracker. This GPS tracker is a true GPS tracker. It uses GPRS, which is cell phone service, and it uses GPS. All of the other trackers that are on the market are either one or the other. So it's a true standalone GPS and is being tested right now. So very close to going to market with that. The wireless video system that Todd talked about, we can't talk about the customer, but really the basis of that video system is a safety system for a very, very, very large company, international company, and it's to help keep their employees safe. And then on top of that, we're a preferred service department for Idaho Power. Idaho Power runs drones, they count salmon, they do all kinds of things with drones. And we're also the preferred service provider for Empire Unmanned. Empire Unmanned is an, they run all of the FedEx flights from California, they run all the FedEx flights to Spokane, but they also do service for bridges, the state of Idaho. So they'll go out and measure a bridge with their drone. We do all the service on their drones. This puts us in a really unique position to work with all kinds of commercial clientele, real estate agents. I mean, we've just barely scratched the surface of what drones are going to be able to do. What you're seeing now is a lot of what you saw in the computer industry in the 90s. Like, we had no idea that we were going to be sitting here today, able to, you know, launch a satellite to the moon on, you know, with a little laptop. And that's really where we're at in the drone market, just barely scratching the surface. That also gives us a unique position to work with military contracts. And we do have a few customers that we're working with now, and we're in negotiation to possibly do some of that. So, forward thinking, but... From there, how we've been marketing our products is we really have wanted to become a friend of the drone community. We want to be first on everybody's mind. And the way we've done that is we've worked with large races around the world, one of them being the Dubai Drone Grand Prix. that was $1 million purse race. So we sent a racer over there, had extremely fast lap times, but he crashed out. Happens when you race. So we didn't get any of that pot. It would have been really nice. From there, we've done IDR North America. We've worked with the Indian Reservation in Washington. Our very first race that we worked with was a ride underground in Virginia, and that was a cave race. So it was flown at night, neon lights everywhere. It was an amazing race. And then top of that, Dalton has done a tremendous job working with DSA and ESPN to get us on television. And in fact, they will re-air the national race, which I'll talk about here in a second, tonight at 9. So
on ESPN.
On ESPN2. Yeah. Perfect. The National Drone Racing Championships, which Todd talked about, was held on Governor's Island in New York. And it was amazing. Statue of Liberty right there, skyline in New York. And we took two racers out, Sorrell and Conrad.
There it is.
This is Conrad Ferrati Miller, and this is his son, Sorrell. He's 12, almost, or he just turned 13. They both raced out at Nationals for us. Sorrell crashed out in the semifinals. He's a really, really fast racer. And you're gonna see, that's why I talked about it being the Xbox of the future. It's Xbox on steroids. You're gonna see kids getting into this because of their hand-eye, thumb coordination is, you know, they've grown up staring at the TV. So, Ferrati, Conrad, took fourth place. And he crashed out in the final round. Right out of the gate, caught an antenna, crashed out. We think, with the speeds that he was running, he could have been first or second. But what that did was that pushed us to Drone Worlds in Hawaii next month. And a chance, another shot at some advertising on ESPN, and another shot at a big time race. So from there, what that takes us to is how and when we're gonna get to the market. We are finishing up our 20 demo boards this week. And in fact, we delivered one yesterday to a very large distributor Todd talked about. We can't release the name, but top three distributors in the United States. We're doing our final production testing on our production boards and getting ready to run our first production run in mid-October. We have kind of two production lines there, talking about 1,000 units in November, 1,300 in October. Those are really the same production run, but we need to break our production down into smaller scale, just because this is the first time, you know, we bit that off, a big production run like that, and we want to make sure that we're perfect. Distribution and sales, we're working with a current distributor in England, UAS, and they have signed a distribution contract for 5,000 units over the next 2 years. And I think it's 12,000 units over the next 5 years. We have a verbal commitment with a very large online retailer. And we're in that contracting phase right now. Obviously, we've been out this week gathering commitments from other distributors. That will happen. EJ's going on a big road trip, leaving tomorrow, right?
Yeah.
And going to hit another one of the largest distributors in the United States on that road trip. And I think that's all I have. That's it.
The next one is the commercial. This is the commercial that aired.
Oh, ESPN. That's right. This is our ESPN commercial. And I would invite you guys to, if you guys have ESPN2, watch us tonight. The first 10 minutes of that program on ESPN is all thrust UAV. Everything, all the filler, almost everybody on there is it's all thrust. So they gave us some great love.
Don't settle for different. Be disruptive. Be a little bit Jekyll and a little bit Hyde. Lend attention to detail with an attitude. Be both beauty and the beast. The new Riot 250R Pro. Get yours at thrust-uav.com.
I should mention that when that commercial aired, and I think it's about the middle of that episode, the DSA Nationals episode, within the first 30 seconds we had
60
signups to our website in 30 seconds. It was crazy. Over the lifespan of our marketing campaign that we've been pushing Thrust UAV and the Riot, I think we've signed up nearly 600 people. That's a big number for us. So, you guys have any specific questions? I think our questions are next, but is that okay?
Yeah.
I'll turn it back over to the chairman.
Thank you. Okay, we'll open it up to questions of anything you guys have.
What is signed up mean? We've been, the drone marketplace is driven by social media. And if you go onto Facebook, if you go onto Instagram and you look drones up, there are hundreds on there. And so what we've been doing, we've also been pushing through social media to bring signups to win a free Riot. And what we're doing is we're just trying to push the word out. So that's what those signups are. So they went to our website, they physically went to our website. The very first thing that they see is win a free Riot. So.
And I do want to clarify what Joe said about on USA. We have a distribution agreement on that. We do not have a signed contract stating that they're
correct,
that they're going to buy. That's what they have to meet in order to hit their goals, and that's what they felt they could do. I just want to clarify that.
Yeah.
Because there's a big,
sorry about
big
that.
Difference.
From previous experiences, I know where the difference.
Any other questions?
There's one from online, what the R&D budget will be for this year.
I don't know that we've said it yet.
At least on the thrust side, our R&D is basically done. We're ready to go to market. You know, obviously we need to bring in all of that production material so we can produce. But outside of that, our R&D budget is, you know.
That part of it's done.
Yeah, and unless the market really points out something that we say, gosh, you know, that's definitely value add. But
we don't have a total answer at this time for that. Sorry.
Russ, there's a wholly owned company within PCS.
Yes, it is.
How do investors understand the value of PCS relative to thrust? Because there's no obvious link between language and titles, thrust, PCS. How do investors get the equivalents?
Well, it kind of, I'm gonna let Robert handle that one.
Yeah, that's that is an education piece. So a lot of the things that we've pushed out in terms of press and explaining why we joined the companies helps quantify, you know, the basis why we did it, which all of these connections between STEM education and the technology that's going into the drone space, I mean, it makes perfect sense. What we're working on is trying to bring, you know, the brands closer together so that it makes more sense. And that's not easy because the branding is very different. Obviously, you know, you've got K-12 STEM education and you've got, you know, high testosterone performance racing products. So those will become closer and closer together, and we're working on a plan to actually rebrand the company that'll help answer that question.
So it's not just a simple matter of calling it PCS/thrust.
No, it's confusing, which is why you brought the question up, and we recognize that. And yeah, we've got some very smart people working on, I think, the forward-looking strategy to bring those together.
Can I add something? Yeah. I think sales would also do that, and I think that you, as investors, are right on the cusp of seeing an explosion. PCS has never, we've had great products, not cutting anything down that we've had, but we've never had our hands on something quite like the drone marketplace.
But the point is, you want to keep the PCS brand, right?
Correct, yeah. Yeah, we've got tremendous recognition in the market now for the Edventures brand of products. So yeah, that won't go away. We just need to figure out how to tell the story so it's clear to shareholders as well.
Any other questions? Well, that concludes our annual meeting then, unless you guys have, you have anything else to add?
Everyone here is invited to come out to the Thrust warehouse.
We would love to have you out there.
Get a demonstration.